You're on community radio station. This is CFWN-FM, Northumberland 89.7.
The views and opinions expressed by the hosts and guests of Reality Realty are not necessarily the views or opinions of Northumberland 89.7-FM. The information given is designed to be informative and helpful. You should always consult a professional when buying or selling your home.
Basically, there's only 2 weeks left in August. This could be your last chance to have some summer vacation. It's certainly likely your last chance to maybe top up what you already had. Enjoy the last bit of the summer weather and the family. It's also the time when property sellers might be wondering, why have my showing slowed down? Or they might be thinking, maybe we need an open house, or maybe we need to put this house in the local newspaper. Well, maybe your marketing is just spot on, and maybe families are enjoying these last few weeks of August. So later this morning, Aaron Farrow and I, we're going to be debunking this real estate marketing paradox. And why? It's because this is Reality Realty. And I'm Dale Bryant, and I'm a real estate broker with Royal LePage Pro Alliance Realty Brokerage. And at this time each week, we bring you Northumberland 89.7 FM's Reality Realty, your local real estate forum, where we take on, talk about, and interview guests on all things real estate with a direct focus on Northumberland County and the communities within it. Let's begin today's show with Snapshot for August 15, 2019. It's a look at the residential real estate market right here in Northumberland County. There have been 121 single-family residential sales over the past month, and that is down 27 sales since our August 1st report. It leaves us with an increasing inventory that's reached a recent high of 508 residential listings for sale. Average selling price of successful sales over the past year has risen again. It is up $3,000 over our last report to approximately $438,000 for the average sale price. During the past year, people have received on average approximately 98% of their list price in a market time of 46 days. And we are in a seller's market with an absorption rate at approximately 24%, meaning we have a residential home in this inventory that can satisfy approximately 4.2 months of sales at the rate homes have been selling. I researched these Northumberland County statistics, and I calculate the absorption rate using information from CoreLogic's Matrix system. And Matrix is the local realtor component of the MLS system. So if you're thinking of buying or selling a home, you want this information to be area specific to the property type you're dealing with and the price band you're dealing in as well. So talk to your local realtor to understand the Northumberland market information that's most relevant to you. Today's mortgage rates. 5-year fixed is down slightly. It stands at 2.59%, and the 5-year variable remains still at 2.85%. And today's mortgage rates come to us from mortgage broker Carol Ann Bryant with Dominion Lending Centers Alliance. And as always, some conditions do apply with rates. That, folks, is your current snapshot of the residential real estate market and events in Northumberland County. And I would just like to remind all who are listening, the views and opinions expressed on Reality Realty and any of the articles that may be presented do not necessarily represent the views and opinions of the station, of the Northumberland Hills Association of Realtors, or of any other real estate brokerage or realtor. There simply are views and opinions at this time. And now I would like to welcome Aaron Farrow. Aaron Farrow is a guest this morning, and he is a sales representative with Royal LePage Pro Alliance Realty Brokerage. Good morning and welcome back, Aaron.
Good morning, Dale. Thank you for having me back.
Yeah. Have you, when I did the stats there, and we were at a 20% absorption rate, we were at a 24% absorption rate, and it is so close to balanced compared to what we're used to. Just wondering if you're noticing a difference in your own business that you know, the advantage isn't to the seller.
Yeah, when we're used to our perpetual seller's market.
Yeah, which it still is, you know, officially,
sure.
But we're getting so close to balance this week.
Which is weird, which is a little weird for the market, but I'm noticing it a little bit with days on market.
Mm-hmm.
A little less activity on showings.
Yeah.
That's really where I'm seeing it too. Maybe certain properties I'm used to seeing maybe 3-4 a week, it's maybe teetering 2-3.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit, but I mean, that usually does play into the August market a little bit as well before the fall picks up.
For sure.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. Just like I mentioned, people do. They want to enjoy this beautiful weather if they at all can. I mean, if they're working, they still have, unless you're a realtor, you still have time off in between working hours and other jobs too.
Sure.
I mean, yeah.
Cottage season's winding down, so a lot of people want to go enjoy the cottage, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we're going to debunk. This is a beautiful thing about our show here. We just, you know, decades old issues. We just settle them right here.
Sure. Yeah. Everyone tunes in to listen to marketing. What are they going to say? This is what we need to know.
Yeah, we're going to debunk the real estate marketing paradox.
Sure.
Yeah. Paradox.
So strong word.
A strong
when
word.
You sent me the title for this week, so I'm like, paradox, okay.
Yeah. So, you know, I fess up, just really trying to make it dramatic.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Why wouldn't we? We're in the entertainment business.
100%.
Education/entertainment.
Yeah.
So, but there is some neat stuff. There's some really neat stuff we're going to be talking about today. And so this marketing, I'm going to keep referring to it as a marketing paradox.
Mm-hmm.
This marketing paradox for selling real estate in particular, I mean, it holds true. Marketing holds true pretty much everywhere.
Sure.
To some fundamental concepts like know your target audience.
Mm-hmm.
Where does that work in, Aaron, with real estate?
Well, I mean, I'm a big fan of marketing and creative marketing, and in real estate, I think marketing has become a huge platform in the efficiency that you can provide when selling homes. I think in terms of target market, you got to think, okay, this is a house that I have. This is where it's pricing. Where do I expect my buyer to come from? Where am I looking to find them? Who am I looking to showcase the property to? I want to attract them to it because I think this matches what they're looking for.
Yeah. Is it a first-time home buyer? Is it a growing family?
Sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, first we need to know who they are. And then once we know who they are, we have a little clue as to how to talk to them,
right?
How to communicate with them. I mean, there might be some slight variations in where to reach these buyers, and I'm gonna, you know, sort of give away a little bit, but we're gonna talk about technology, internet technology, in a little bit. But really and truly, there's a surprising amount of retired, mature people who are downsizing,
mm-hmm,
that are into technology.
Sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So there are going to be some differences how we communicate, but there's always going to be commonality,
yes,
isn't there?
And also too, like first-time home buyers, because you brought it up, it's even how you communicate with them about the property and what you're marketing to them. I mean, as a first-time home buyer, you want to probably, they should be attracted to something that's sound, has a good roof, windows, but those are features you want to bring out, market that, attract that, and then something that could be a cosmetic upgrade for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. So I mean, fundamentals, know our target audience, know how to communicate with them, and then it becomes an education, marketing, an education where you're showing you're showing potential buyers the benefits.
Yes.
Of living there.
Yes.
You know, and I just I got two here I put down. When you tell them the benefits, you want a strong call to action.
Sure.
And craft something like that. And then this is a key one, I think, is monitor, measure, and then learn.
Mm-hmm.
Test what you do.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get married to it. And see if it measures up and if it works.
Like any smart business, right?
Yeah.
And two, when you're talking about what to say and the marketing and how you're going to portray it, I think you have to be aware, too, of what your competitive advantage is,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, especially with a product like a house, you have to say, okay, if we have a few houses in the mid 400 range and you're at a, you know, and you're trying to sell the property, you want to, you know, focus on what does this property have that the others don't, and really make sure that those facts are getting across.
Yeah, exactly. And know what you have.
Sure.
Know what you have and flaunt it.
Absolutely.
Put it out there.
And a call to action too. When you know those, I mean, if it's in the first line of your bio on the MLS listing, your call to action should just be absolutely showcasing those features that you have that put your property above the rest. It should be the first thing that everyone sees.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, I mean, when somebody comes in a home, they know, and we talked about it before when we did a series on flipping, investment flipping. And there's a couple ways to gauge it, but one way is, and I believe you might have said this, you know, in the first 6 feet.
Yeah, first impression.
Yeah, your first impression when you walk in the door. Some people will say, you know, in the first 30 seconds. It's all pretty much the same thing, just gauged differently. And the same thing when you're talking about the description, when
sure.
we upload. I mean, we only get so many fonts. We can't write a real big story
no.
there. But even in that limited number of fonts, if nothing's happening in the first line or two, it could be easy just to stop reading.
Sure. First impression is everything.
Yeah.
That first impression from the first step into the house, the first impression of the first photo that is put up on the
mm-hmm.
listing, how the first line reads. These are all things that people are either going to say, because we have such short attention spans. I like this. I'll read further. Or let's go to the next one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, what we're going to do, and I have this beautiful chart. I have this chart that was put out by the National Association of Realtors, and they do a survey annually, and they don't necessarily survey what people think might work or what people hope might work, but they survey buyers and sellers and say what did work.
Mm-hmm.
When you were selling your home, what worked? When you bought your home, what worked? And then they tally up, I mean, this huge amount of information, and they publish it once a year, and I always buy it. And then it's a great insight
sure.
to help say where should the efforts be in marketing. So why don't we look at bottom up?
Bottom up. I think bottom up's the way to do it.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So and we'll just elaborate on what's going on with each and every one. And so the bottom one there, well, we don't need to do other.
What is other?
Other was, so we're going to be looking at a chart, and it says where the buyer found the home that they purchased. So what actually effectively reached out to that buyer and connected them to the home? And we got a chart that starts way back in
2008.
2001, all the way up to last year,
yep.
2018. So it'll be neat to see the dynamics of how these things changed, even not just what they are today, but a little history on them.
Absolutely.
So what's bottom, other than other, which other was less than 1%. It just had an asterisk there and
yep.
said less than 1%. So what is our lowest one that we actually know what it is?
Home, book, or magazine.
So we're not going to mention any brands.
No. We're trying to sabotage ourselves on the show here, Dale.
But a home book. I mean, we see this like a coffee table sort of book, magazine.
Yeah. Maybe a monthly publish.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm thinking I see them that will have real estate in the magazine. And so they're giving us the effectiveness of that one. What do we got there, Aaron?
Well, we got, after 2009 to last year, we have less than 1%. Carrying on furthermore, 2001, we showed 2% of buyers from a home book or magazine. But yeah, nothing. It looks like it's going to just continue to stay that way.
Yeah, so, I mean...
Which you can understand.
We've been since 2009 at less than 1% effectiveness.
Yeah.
And its heyday, leading up like from 2001, we have 1 year at 2%. No, 2 years at 2%, and another five of them at 1% effectiveness. So.
And I'm sure that could probably play into the fact that, you know, there could be a good chance by the time the properties go into that and then get published, they could even be sold.
Yeah.
Right.
A smart buyer isn't referencing these home book or magazines to find the right home.
Right.
They're not going to be competitive as far as timing.
No, definitely not.
It's not going to, it's print. It can't tell the whole story.
Well, the other thing too is, I mean, it's not like you can flip through photos. There's probably a limited amount of information that can get put on the page.
Yeah. Yeah. You would need a 1 to 2 page ad.
Sure.
To show everything that potentially a listing can tell you, which is another medium. So, have you bothered with any home book magazines?
I've actually, the interesting thing, when I first started real estate, I wanted to try every single marketing technique. I've kind of found out what works for me. But one of the things that I did find is with a home book or magazine, I'd be getting a call and it'd be maybe 1 or 2 weeks after the house had already been off the market or sold conditional. Mm-hmm. And it didn't seem to be. And the other thing too is by the time that issue comes out and then a new issue is launched, well, that previous issue that you've paid to be a part of is now obsolete, unlike maybe something else that we'll talk about later that could last endlessly.
Yeah, I did.
What about you, Dale?
I did about 5 years.
Yeah.
5 years. So
Good commitment.
I'm a Toronto Maple Leaf fan, right?
you know how to be patient.
I just don't go away easy.
Sadly, I am too, Dale. So I understand.
So I tried for 5 years. Within that 5 years, monitor, measure, learn.
How did you find it?
I switched my whole perspective from advertising the house to advertising me.
Yeah.
Because really and truly, at the end of the day, if everybody is to be honest, it's a realtor that benefits, I think, from that.
Yes.
Because they're seen.
Yeah, and you make a good point. In the short span that I did, I didn't do it for 5 years, but I did it for about 6 months. In the span that I did it, I had more calls come in saying, hey, we saw you in this. Can you come see our property, give us an idea where we stand, than I actually did helping my sellers.
Yeah.
And it became more about personal marketing. And it really wasn't the place I was trying to do that or the objective I was trying to gain. So it was a bit counterproductive.
Monitor and learn, though.
Monitor and learn.
Yeah. So that's our first one. And sadly, that's really low. The lowest labeled item. Aaron, after this break, we're going to start working our way up this chart. Some of these won't take too long to discuss and then, you know, likely be more discussion right near the top.
Perfect.
So, folks, don't go away. You've been listening to Reality Realty on Northumberland 89.7 FM, truly local radio, and we've been talking about debunking the real estate marketing paradox. You are going to hear things here over this next 40 minutes that you will hear nowhere else. We'll be right back.
When was the last time you enjoyed a great weekend morning show? Well, the wait is over. The early morning wake-up has the cure for the common weekend. No dial-hopping necessary. Just great music and great features like our School of Hard Rock, our Boombox Classic, plus your wake-up weather forecast, and just the right amount of talk. That's the Early Morning Wake-Up, now at its new time, 6 a.m., 6 to 9, every Saturday morning on Northumberland 89.7, truly local radio.
Cancer connects us all. We all have a story to tell.
I was 13 years old when I first heard the word cancer.
Being diagnosed with colon cancer was an overwhelming shock.
I'm Eric McCormack. Research, including clinical trials, helps to change the story for cancer patients across Canada.
I am now 9 years cancer-free.
Join Stand Up to Cancer Canada and the Canadian Cancer Society to learn more about the groundbreaking research that translates into life-saving treatments. Visit standuptocancer.ca/CCS to learn more.
Welcome back. This is Northumberland, 89.7 FM's Reality Realty with Dale Bryant. And our guest this morning is Aaron Farrow. And Aaron is a real estate sales representative with Royal LePage ProLiance Realty Brokerage. And we are in the same office. So, Aaron, we just touched the surface here on debunking the conundrum, the mystery behind effective real estate marketing.
Yes.
Because, I mean, how much of it do you think is obvious, and how much do you think is you need to be in the industry to see?
I think it's somewhat obvious. You can just see where society as a whole is leaning, where you see mm-hmm. business marketing, and it's similar. It all plays out the same. However, the next one we're going to talk about actually surprised me the most of all of them. I thought it would have been higher.
Yeah.
I do.
And that is?
Print newspaper advertisement.
Yeah, so before the break, we were talking about homebook magazines and, that sort of coffee table mm-hmm. Publishing. And this is print newspaper. Mm-hmm. What were you surprised about it? What were you thinking? What did it end up being?
That over the, well, I guess since what? Deal. Since 2012, it's been teetering at 1%. Yeah. I feel like a lot of agents still use it as a source of marketing, and mm-hmm. I feel like people talk about it, and the public, like I know when I go in for listing appointments, they go, oh, and does it go in the newspaper?
Yeah.
And I'm surprised that when people are so public about it, that it's as low as it is. I would have thought that would have been teetering around the 5% range.
Yeah, but it is. It just cracked a number.
Yeah.
It hit 1% effectiveness. Mm-hmm. So, when people are saying, "Hey, Dale. Hey, Aaron. Where's all the viewings?" And it's August 15th, and they're wondering if maybe their house has to get in the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's because people are enjoying some time off instead.
Sure.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're missing that 1%.
No. Right? No. And I mean, it wasn't part of the marketing fundamentals that I pulled and mentioned at the beginning of the show, but focusing on effective marketing as opposed to ineffective marketing should have been one of those points.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right. So, I mean...
Did you ever do print advertisement? Newspaper?
I did that quite a while too.
Yeah.
I did that quite a while too. And I did that back when I was a newer agent.
Sure. Trying it out.
Trying it out because so part of, in my world anyways, and I know it's in your world too. As realtors, we have to sell ourselves.
Sure.
I mean, this biggest transaction in people's lives is where all the chips are, and they need to be able to trust that we have the competence and the savvy and we can do it effectively, not just get it done, but get it done well. So we're selling ourselves. Mm-hmm. Then we have to sell the home.
Yes.
And we have to help work with the client to make the home sellable. At times. And then if you're in a market that's a little slower, a little closer to balanced, and you don't have a sale in week one and two, we often find ourselves selling ourselves some more, don't we?
As in, yes, you should still trust me. Yes,
yes.
I'm still the guy or the girl. I can get this done.
Yeah. Doubt
sets in.
I know. And rightfully so. It's important.
Sure it is.
Or the sign likely wouldn't have went on the lawn.
Yeah.
But And so, you know, would somebody put an ad in the newspaper just to show I'm still here and I'm still working for you, maybe? And maybe that's part of what I was doing. Okay. When I started in real estate.
Sure. Check the boxes kind of thing. Yeah.
Because, you know, at the very beginning, we're trying to decide who we are, right. where we can make a difference. I mean, if you're ambitious and you're a deep thinker, like I know you are, and I know I am, you're trying to figure out what works, what doesn't work. And so with my limited knowledge at first, I did it because it was showing people I was still breathing and thinking about them. And also, it was getting my name out there.
Did you find it had a similar effect to the magazine situation, though, where it became a little bit more about the agent than the property itself?
Yeah, I would get the odd phone call from that, but way more phone calls were happening through the internet. I mean,
yeah,
just dwarfing it, and I can't remember that I ever actually had a good call. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the difference between a lead and a good lead, I would say that good leads come from serious people, and serious people are not going to the newspaper for their listing inventory.
They're motivated today and right now. Right? Yeah. So they want the fastest access, mm-hmm. and they're eager to get out there as soon as they can. Yeah. That makes total sense.
Yeah, you're having a nice morning coffee, and you're sitting back, and you might look at that newspaper, and you might thumb through, and you might even make an inquiry because, you know, in the next 2 or 3 years, you might want to move.
Exactly.
So we got the print. You know, basically print. Print's great for a lot of things. It just
maybe not for real estate.
It's definitely if we look at the facts. So next one here on the list, Aaron, the home became visible to the buyer directly from sellers or people who knew the sellers.
Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah. That's going to happen, right?
Yeah, one that I think will kind of teeter as it had. Like, I mean, you look at 2001, 4%, 2018, 3%, and in between it's gone up to 5, down to 1 year, yeah. But mainly within a few percentile. I mean, that's probably just word of mouth, right? That'll probably carry on as it is.
Yeah, for sure. And that's always, it's a marketing thing that is costing nobody any money.
Mm-hmm.
So if it works, 3% or 4%?
Yeah.
I mean, good for that 3 or 4%. And every now and again, I get asked this question, Aaron, by a potential seller, and they say, you know, Dale, we'd like to sell with you, list with you, but we know a friend or a friend of a friend or a family member who is interested in possibly buying it. And I'm all for it. You know what? If you can do a direct, good for you folks. Not everybody can. Only 3 or 4% can.
Right.
And, you know, all the power to you. And see if that goes through. And then if it doesn't, let's talk. And I can't think of one time that it actually worked out for the folks.
Okay.
Because when you're ready to sell, that person who might be genuinely interested in your home might not be at a place in their life where they're ready.
Sure, and that's just one person versus the entire market.
I mean, and then you have to be content with, will I just be content never knowing what the market would bear?
That's another point too. What if you have a really sellable property? What if you have a property that could hold offers and go above and beyond, or a lot of people would be after it?
Mm-hmm.
Are you doing yourself a disservice?
Yeah, I mean, we see, even as realtors who see pretty much everything, we sometimes get surprised at how much a home sells for, right?
All the time.
Yeah. And you go, whoa, wouldn't have expected that.
Right.
That's really high. So if you're those 3 or 4% people, 3% this year or last year rather, if you're in that price category and you can feel good mm-hmm. about not knowing what the open market could bear, then you know, it still might be the right move.
I would imagine, too, that may be, like, it'd be interesting to see of the percentages there that did that, what was the average home price? maybe you could assume that it's maybe a higher price point and they're doing it as well to mitigate expenses.
Yeah. Or if it's somewhere, one like my nephew or, or you know, my absolute closest friend's daughter or something, and then maybe you just go, you know what, I just want what's fair. I don't care what I could have got. Right. I feel good about potentially letting them have a good deal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that happens too.
Definitely.
Not all life is on a ledger, but a great deal of it is.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so something to look at. What do we got next here,
Aaron? Next one. We have home builder or their agent. So this one's interesting how it kind of rises, falls, and rises again, almost like it's running with that exponential curve of the market.
Mm-hmm.
Between balanced or a buyer's market or a seller's market, how it kind of follows that similar curve over what almost looks like an 8-year span.
Yeah, so this has got to be, it is, but it's, it absolutely is in a wave pattern here, but this home builder or their agent, this is new builds, I would say, right?
Yes.
This is new builds, and it's either the builder directly or somebody in the sales thing. So yeah, that's only accounting for this past year 5% of sales. So
still nothing drastic, still nothing major. Interesting too that 2016 showed 2%, right, in that crazy hot market when maybe builders were very busy as well, when it was only showing 2%, when the rest of the time it's teetered really, what, Dale, around 4, 5, 6?
Yeah. We're seeing more up around the 3 and 4, I think. Likely that'd be the average. But also, it doesn't mean that's only the amount of new homes that have been selling. It's just that's how many people went directly to the builder or to the builder's sales agent.
Right.
I mean, often us realtors, we can take our clients into a new subdivision, and most developers will cooperate with a realtor and allow the realtor to work in combination with the buyers. So I mean, it doesn't tell the whole story about how many news were purchased, just what percent went directly.
Again, probably another number that probably stays fairly consistent, I would imagine.
Yeah. Next one. The first one was just, the first one we talked about, word of mouth, was just directly from the sellers. Now we actually have from friends, relatives, or neighbors.
Yes.
Is more effective than the seller themselves, but it's just, you've just multiplied how many mouths are there, right?
Yes. Yeah. And I mean, pretty consistent as well throughout. Not a whole lot of change in that. I was thinking about this, I wonder if they gauge this on like a physical, you know, conversation in person or a phone call versus, I know, like on Facebook or anything like that. Is that also when you're commenting your spouse's name or you're commenting a friend's name, word of mouth that way? Because that'd be interesting as well.
Yeah, I mean, and so everybody that does this survey might have read it differently, too. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's not 100% accuracy, but it certainly takes us in good directions. And this one here, friend, a relative, or neighbor, this year we're at 7%.
We're starting to get up there.
Yeah, it's getting up there from where we started out. At 1% and 3%, you know, 1% for newspaper and 3% for, you know, the sellers knowing people direct. But it's still relatively low odds.
Maybe worth doing like a VIP open house for the neighbors, like an hour or so before your own open house. Have all the neighbors come through, drop off an invite on their doorstep.
Well, you mentioned open house. So we're going right into...
Easy segue.
We're going right into what I think is a controversial marketing technique. So our next one here, and actually it's tied at 7% effectiveness this year.
Consistently decreasing too.
Yeah, but this is actually... This is actually the open house sign or a yard sign. So this is actually, you know, at first we're looking at signage. Mm-hmm. So somebody, you have an open house. How many signs do you put around it for an open house?
3 to 5. It depends on the corners and stuff. Like, it's a country property. I'm not going to put it 4 miles down the road, but a handful.
Yeah. I put as many as I can. and reason being, I don't really feel, and we'll get into this in a minute, but I don't believe in the effectiveness of the open house. And I share that with
Elaborate
my seller.
For me. What do you think?
Well, let us get done the signs first, and then we'll get into that. So I let my sellers know I don't believe in an open house. I don't believe them to be effective in 95% or better of the time. So they know that. But if they want an open house, I will gladly do an open house. And because they know how I feel, I make sure that open house gets done really well. I don't ever want my client to think, Dale just half-heartedly did that open house. So I will put up signs. I will put up signs like crazy.
Have a nice spread on the counter. So you got drinks and food out.
I don't do drinks and food because I really don't want people coming in and making a mess in the house. I know that's a common thing that, you know, you're just trying to make them, have a feeling about that home. It was an inviting home, you know, but really and truly, I get down to serious buyers. You're serious. You don't need the cup of whatever.
I'm not allowed to be frivolous.
And... I don't know what happened there.
Siri going off.
Yeah, Siri.
Right now.
Siri recognized something there and has something to say. So, anyways, I get right back to the serious buyer, and they're not going to be influenced by, you know, little snacks or chocolates or a refreshing drink.
Good chance too when they see that property come up, they're just going to call their agent and book a private showing, or call you individually and register a showing as well.
Yeah. But I mean the sign only, 7%. So 7% effectiveness is in combination, the for sale sign and the open house sign. So people driving around seeing those signs for open house and just driving by, you know, you got your regular routines in life and you see a house for sale and then you think that, oh man, I've always thought if that house came up for sale.
Higher than I thought it would be, though.
The sign.
Yeah.
Yeah. So have a good sign.
Surprisingly.
Yeah. Yeah, have a good sign. And so people can take down the information easily and do a next step. All right, so the sign. But how about the actual open house itself? What are your feelings?
Well, I think for me it depends on the property, too. I think... Also, too, depending on the day of the week that I list, I don't mind the open houses. I like to do them on the first weekend that you're up for 3-4 hours and have people come through. But I also find as the price point of the house increases, they become even less effective. I think they're great in your starter homes. I think you get a lot of people actively out and looking at them. But I haven't found them as productive on higher range properties.
No.
What about you?
I've just found them to be a waste of time. Unless you take into account, once again, I'm out there in front of the community. People will meet me. They might say, oh, you know what? They drive away saying, I wouldn't mind working with that Dale Bryant guy.
Right.
And I can pick up business from doing an open house. And because I meet people, but... Never sell a house from it. I mean, because the general public doesn't realize necessarily that they're limited in their effectiveness, they're afraid of an open house, right? If I have a buyer who sees a house they like and they find out the open house is on this Saturday,
they want to get there Friday.
They don't want to wait till the open house,
right?
Because they think, oh, they're going to have 3 or 4 offers.
Mm-hmm.
which I've never had. But, you know, you can't help but think about that if you're really interested in the house. So they want in before it so that they have a chance to write an offer and not even let them have an open house.
Right. Yeah, beat the rush. You make a good point there.
Yeah.
You make a good point there. More of a marketing tactic and tool maybe as well than the actual effectiveness. But again, you know, a little more about the agent too, potentially in how it works out than the house itself.
Yeah. Let's continue this. We're going to take a break, folks, and we'll be right back after this short break, and we'll talk a little bit more about the open house, but then we're going to move on to the two biggies, and we'll finish up that way.
Billy Bones, Silver Bullet, Boss Hogs, Bibs, Uncle Sam's, Jack on the Bone Barbecue.
They're the princes of pork, the titans of taste, the maestros of meat, and they're throwing down at Coburg's Victoria Park, August 16th through 18th. It's Rotary Club of Coburg's Northumberland Rib Fest and Music Festival. Music Saturday night features Song Remains, tribute to Led Zeppelin. On Sunday, change it up a bit with Sounds of Motown, a tribute to the legends of Motown, plus live entertainment at the Bandshell all weekend, the Marketplace, and more. The Northumberland Rib Fest and Music Festival is back, and better than ever. August 16th through 18th, a fun, safe family event. And admission is absolutely free. For all the delicious details, visit NorthumberlandRibFest.ca.
And remember to stop by the Northumberland 89.7 booth at RibFest.
Welcome back. This is your local real estate forum, Northumberland 89.7 FM's Reality Realty, with Dale Bryant and Aaron Farrell. And Aaron, before the break, we were getting into the open house. We talked about the effectiveness of the open house signs. Yes. And the for sale sign being a 7% effectiveness. We don't actually have a number here on the actual open house itself, because if somebody found out about the open house maybe through online, then they might have answered the survey to say, I saw it online first.
Yeah, or friends and family referral, or the sign driving by.
Yeah, and yeah, so it's hard to track that from this here, but we were talking about effectiveness of the open house, and I know I've done an entire show on it before.
It's a passionate topic.
Yeah, well, I found a realtor who was... promoted the open house.
Okay.
and claimed it worked. And then I found another realtor who, well, and then I had my opinions, and then I found another realtor who, you know, realized the limitations of the open house, but still was, not as discouraged with the effectiveness as I was. Mm-hmm. So I tried to get a mix up in there, and it was a great talk. But anyways, I'm completely happy to do an open house if my client wants it, but I'm going to show him some of these figures and say, is this really where we want to spend our efforts?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because now we're getting into the big ones, the heavy yeah. hitters now. Everything else has been that we've talked about has been so insignificant.
Yeah, like everything else is not even a quarter of the remaining two.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.
even a quarter.
Yeah, put them together and it's not even there.
No. Yeah. So next we have the real estate agent themselves.
Right. So this is the realtor finding the house mm-hmm. and saying, hey, buyer, what about this one?
Sure.
You finding that you Absolutely. Have that happen more than...
Yeah, and for myself... A lot higher even than the percentage that's here. I have, you know, we are in a more of a retirement demographic out here. And I have quite a few clients who maybe aren't using the realtor app on their phone or aren't on social media that say, can you please email me a bunch of properties? And we have them set up and they're getting on the daily emailed listings sent to them. And I would like it's showing 28% for last year, but I would say right now it's much higher than that.
Yeah, and so that I mean, do you use automated searches?
I do.
Yeah, so that means you're getting to them before they actually even see the automated search results.
Yes.
And which is really good because you're right on top of things. I mean, and that can happen in certain seasons when when we have some time to review before. But if we're, I mean, there's times it works for me like that too. But then there's times I'm getting started on the day very early, and right away I got to meet for, you know, we got 5 URL listings to view. Mm-hmm. Well, then chances are the client's going to see that automated search result come in before I actually do.
Absolutely.
Depending what time of day it gets loaded, right?
Sure.
But
it helps you as a team stay on top of it as well, right? Yeah. You're providing the ability for that benefit to be there, and then whether it's yourself or the client seeing it, at least you're seeing it right away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And the automated search is very effective with limitations. I mean, we know our clients, right?
Yes.
And we have the filters in our minds that can certainly eliminate potential listings right off the get-go.
Yes. But sometimes still not narrowing it down completely as well to where you'd want to be.
Yeah.
But it definitely clears up some options.
Yeah. So a lot of value in, and if your realtor can spot things that maybe didn't get uploaded correctly, and maybe a piece of criteria that we were looking for in the search
didn't pull it up.
And we can notice these things and potentially say, hey, did you think about this one?
Yeah.
You know, you said you must have a garage and this one doesn't.
Yeah.
But it has tons of room for a garage, and the price is so good,
yeah,
you could easily get a new garage put in. So yeah, those things.
Yeah, perfect example. I was working with some clients just a few months ago, and they really needed 5 bedrooms and minimum of 2 bathrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And the listing was uploaded as a 4-bed, 1-bath and had been sitting. And we looked at the photos and, oh, there's 5 bedrooms, 2 bathrooms here. Let's go take a look. And it was the perfect home for them.
Yeah.
But the
criteria is, I mean, a good thing, but not perfect.
Like any technology, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So
now the one we've been itching to get to.
Yeah, and I can't do a drum roll. Let's see. That's really small.
That's what we're working with.
Small here. Local radio. Anyways, Biggie, internet.
Yes.
Internet technology. So what are we looking at when we see internet? What's all included in this?
Yeah, your MLS, realtor.ca, right?
Mm-hmm.
The app or the website for the public. You probably would have YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, social media.
Mm-hmm.
What else would we have on top of that? Anything else you could think of?
Yeah. All your social media platforms.
Yeah.
And, you know, some are more obscure than others.
Mm-hmm.
But those platforms for sure. You're looking at websites. So we're looking at realtor.ca. That's the biggie.
Website as well.
Yeah. The agents, the brokerage, quite often the brokerage will have their own site.
Yep.
And with Royal LePage, I mean, it's
IDX
huge.
Integration is great.
Huge brokerage. We got a national site, and then we have the actual brokerage's own site. So, and then we get our own sites.
Yes.
So that gives a lot.
From the sounds of it, I hear DaleBryant.ca has had a beautiful makeover to it.
Yeah, have you had a chance to look at it?
I did take a look at it. It's looking very sharp.
Well, thank you very much,
yeah,
sir. Yeah, great plug there. And
you did have me on today, so I mean, you got to give it back somehow.
Yeah. So, and it's not just putting it on there. It's what you put on there,
sure, content,
right? And
is
how
almost
you
just
do
as
it.
Important.
So, what would you say to that?
Well, I guess to go full circle, when I started, I've tried and spent marketing dollars on all the previous topics that we talked about, and now currently, I've eliminated all of them but internet and social media marketing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, like you said, content is huge. I think visual content, something that has as much depth as possible. It has information, it has visual, it has something that is enticing, that keeps the viewer watching, but also delivers as much information about the property as you want to get across.
Yeah, and one of the things I'm going to say that you do extremely well is video. putting video online. I mean, I do video as well. My approach is entirely different. I'm holding the camera, or I have it on a stand somewhere. And mine is basically like we just met in somebody's living room, and it's pretty casual, and it's basically
but effective,
absolutely effective. Now, Mr. Aaron Farrell, you know what? Your productions, you can call it a production, because you are so polished. You do everything just so beautiful. I mean, I'm fully expecting that one day I'm going to see you on television, because you're just going to outgrow this Northumberland real estate, and you're going to have your own show on homes. Like, wow. Yeah.
I guess me giving you that website plug, you really, that helped in that compliment. Thanks, Dale.
But it's true.
Wow.
It's true.
Well, I found with those videos, and I'll tie it back into, you were talking about your call to action. Mm-hmm. And we talked about having the call to action in the first line of the bio. In my videos, I take that call to action once I have established what my competitive advantage is, and I make that be, you know, the 15 to 20 second intro that I give. Mm-hmm. But I want to make sure that those one or two things that are separating this property apart is being delivered. No matter how it's being delivered, it's everywhere for someone to see.
Yeah, and so you've chosen the video for that platform. Not that you're not doing it somewhere else. I just mentioned the video because it's something you do extraordinarily well. Yeah. My flavor maybe has that, you know. Oh, the complimentary term might be honest approach, just honest and unrehearsed approach. But it's still doing the job that I'm looking for, and I still have video out there.
Yeah, and then it's more about creating the content and then directing it. Like it the content itself is important, mm-hmm. but like we talk about Facebook. Facebook is at the cost per lead that you get on Facebook, and the value that that adds to a listing, how many people you can reach, is an absolute steal. I think it is so valuable. So you take that content and then you properly put it on Facebook, or you put it on YouTube. You mm-hmm. have a YouTube channel, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is, I know, has been a growing. I've never even thought I don't have a YouTube channel, but it's something that
you have videos.
Do.
You exactly. have enough to put on there.
Sure.
And so this internet marketing. We're at 50% for 2018. So, I mean, it's everything we talked about mm-hmm. put together only equals this one yeah. component, which is internet. And
next year, it'll probably be bigger than all together at the rate that
yeah,
it's going.
Yeah, it keeps growing. What do you think about how it's transformed since 2001?
And when it was at 8%? Well,
8%.
It's crazy.
It's not like computers were new then.
No. It's just, and is that how much of that is that's what the buyers are looking for, and that's where they're looking, and how much of that as well is, well, this is also where the agents are marketing a lot as well. Mm-hmm. However, I don't think anyone can deny that it's effective. You talked about know your target audience, how to communicate, educate the benefits, strong call to action, and then the biggest one is monitor, measure, and learn.
Yeah.
You can do a strategic ad on Facebook, check every single box, you get feedback, you could spread a post out to three or four different towns that you think could find that buyer, and then with the remaining budget that you have, you double down on the areas that are working.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's great. I think it's super, super effective, and I think social media marketing is really going to be here for a long time.
Yeah, and we don't know what's in store online, but it does ever evolve. There'll be a new platform that we just have never seen, and it's going to come up in the next 6 months, year, 2 years, whenever, and it'll just dwarf
sure.
so many others. Sure. And so we need to be able to adapt. And so, yeah, when I see the climb of internet, even just as recently as 2001, yeah. when even as recently as 2006.
It doubled.
Yeah, it was only 24%. Yeah. So it's doubled from over doubled from 2006 to 2018.
Yeah, and the consistency is just is great.
So, part of the reason for the show, if you're concerned, you have your house for sale, and you haven't seen many people viewing over the last few days, or even a couple weeks, mm-hmm. August, the month of August. Take a look at your marketing.
Sure.
And if one of these effective methods, especially internet, if there's a way to make it stronger, then you might want to consider suggesting to make that stronger. But if you have a strong internet presence, you're likely just waiting out the holidays, aren't you?
Yeah, you're sitting back and you're saying, okay, we're here, we're ready.
I mean, unless, of course, price is off. I mean, there's
other variables.
There's variables, and that's a big one. But if you know your price is on and you're just not getting those viewings.
It's just patience.
Don't worry.
Yeah.
Yeah, don't worry. Aaron, thank you so much for reviewing this. I absolutely love this graph.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
It feeds us really exact information. And if somebody is looking for amazing marketing on their home, they have a home to sell in the future, how can they get a hold of you?
Or you.
Or me. But let's talk about you right now.
I mean, you could send me an email at aaron@aaronfarrow.ca or call my cell at 905-396-0489. And I'd be happy to come up with a creative marketing plan and video content to best help your property.
Yeah, and I know focusing on the aspects that are effective. And if you have any questions or comments about today's show or for any real estate questions, feel free to contact me by emailing dale@dalebryant.ca. I'm an active real estate broker with Royal LePage Pro Alliance Realty Brokerage. And don't forget to join me next Thursday from 11 a.m. until 12 noon for Reality Realty on Northumberland 89.7 FM, truly local radio. Until next week, folks.
你好，我是 Jennifer， 来自中国，我依家住喺 Northumberland， 呢度系 Northumberland 89.7 真正嘅本地电台。Hello, my name is Jennifer. I'm from China. Northumberland is now my home, and this is Northumberland 89.7.